Hello again, everyone, and welcome to the Modern Maker Workroom. In this video, we will be discussing collars
and
buttonholes. As we go through each step, I want you to pay special attention to how your body is sitting and how your body is moving. As I often say in classes in person, it's really important to be mindful of how your body works. I like to give you these pulled out shots so that you can see me sitting in my chair and working with my clothes. And that gives you an idea of what a proper posture should be. It should be relaxed. I have a tendency to slouch forward, which you really shouldn't do. But just make sure that you're observing proper posture. In the long run, it'll help speed your work. Thank you so much. Now let's get stitching. Okay, we're getting ready to begin working with the collar and applying the collar onto the body. So I've taken the collar, which goes on this half of the garment. So you can see center front is here, the neckline is here. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to check the amount that I'll need to stretch the front neckline. With this style of doublet, it's usually not very much. So this looks like it should go right in with not very much stretching at all. All I'm doing is stretching enough to just be able to open the neckline. I don't need to forcibly stretch this neckline. There's good shaping already involved in how we've handled the neckline and what we've done here to create the seam on the collar. The shaping of this seam right here helps give the form to the neckline the way we need it. Now that I know what needs to happen with this, I'll go ahead and baste close to the edge here, about an eighth of an inch. And I can do that standing up. Typically, I would say make sure that you sit down for this, but it's such a short distance, I feel like it can be done right here, right now. So I'm going to take the garment, I'm going to flip it this way so that I can work. And I'm only basting this at about a quarter of an inch away from the cut edge. So just a few millimeters, probably 6 millimeters or so. And just giving a very small baste, and that helps secure the neckline in place. We're using a straight stitch as well, a straight baste, because that will help control the neckline and keep it from stretching too far out of shape, given that we're hand sewing the entire thing, and hand manipulation and handling that can really, that can cause the bias edges to stretch a lot. So we're trying to avoid that by using a straight baste and being careful with our handling. Okay, that's done. The next step is to baste the collar in place before we stitch it. And I'm going to do that from the neckline side. So our seam allowance for stitching the true seam is going to be 3/8 of an inch. In this case, I'm going to make my basting quite a bit farther back from the edge, but I'm still lining up the edge as though I were stitching the seam for real. So that way, I'm ready to go when it's time to do the actual back stitching. So you can see me carefully opening the neckline with my fingers as I put this in place. Again, I'm being extra careful to make sure that my cut edges are lined up. Okay, this is in place. Here we are, ready to begin stitching the collar in place into the neckline. Now, this will be a back stitch, and it is going to be about 3/8 of an inch, or just shy of a centimeter. Or right around a centimeter, really. And I'll begin at the left edge the way I did when stitching the lining for the skirts, matching my cut edges. And I will stitch just a few stitches of standard back stitch. And I'll start on the collar side, but now I'm going to switch to the neckline side. And the reason that I do this is because it's very easy, with the neckline being concave,
It's very easy for it to accidentally shift out of position, even with very careful basting. So I want to be able to see it super clearly from this side. And you can see I'm going right above where the wool is. I don't want to be stitching through the wool. Keeping my 3/8 inch seam allowance, making sure with every stitch that I am doing my micro corrections to the stitch angle so that it continues to be a perfect 3/8 of an inch. Sometimes if I'm using a silk, which is like a silk fabric, which is very thin and a much lighter canvas, I will do this seam at 1/4 inch. And that's just because I can get closer to the edge without worrying about the fabric fraying out. However, this I'm using 3/8 inch specifically because I have a fairly coarse interlining and a fairly open weave spongy wool on the outside, which would have a tendency to fray, and I really don't want to give an opportunity for those threads to come out of the weave structure in the neckline here. I'm at the end now. I will take a few stitches in the opposite direction. So I'll do back stitches at the end here. Just 3 is plenty, and I'm done. Now I'll cut this, I'll remove my basting, then I'll stitch the seam allowance open before applying the trim for the neckline. So here I am now removing, I'm just using my needle to grab those basting threads and pull them. I think I'm far enough that I can just grab the knot, just tug it right out, okay? Now that we're here, turn this over, and you can see nice, strong, clean seam. With that done, I have 2 options. I can just stitch it open and keep going, or I can go and press it and then come back and work a little bit more, press a little bit more, but I think less pressing is probably better. So I'll grab my thread and I'll just pick stitch this allowance open. And I'm really not going through that much to the all the way to the outside. Oops, I didn't put a knot on the end of my thread. Pulled it right through. So I'm just going deep enough to catch the canvas in this instance. Since I'll be putting trim on the outside, I'm not that worried about making this tremendously secure because the trim will also catch these layers and keep them in place. All right, I'm gonna turn and go back the other direction, holding this seam allowance into the body. So I'm stitching it open. I'm not relying 100% on the iron to keep these allowances open. Now, the few surviving examples whose seams I've been able to see on the inside, they whip the edge, but that puts any possible exposure of the stitching too far away from the seam line, and I won't be able to cover it with the trim. So I'm using a pick stitching or a running stitch technique and just catching the canvas underneath to make sure that it stays in place before I put the trim on. Okay, so there's my completed seam. Now I feel like I'm going to go to the iron and give this a nice little smash before I put the trim on. So as I begin to put the trim on the neck seam, the technique is exactly the same as it was for the skirt and for the collar seam, like the vertical collar seam. I'm working about an eighth of an inch away from the actual seam line itself. I'm making sure I'm doing a pick right through the center of this trim, and I'm making my stitches small and kind of tight so that it really locks this trim perfectly into position. I definitely want to see the seam. Not trying to stitch over it. I'm not trying to mask it. I want to know that that seam is there. Just trying to frame it attractively. As I reach the seam line, I'm actually going to take one back stitch in the line of trim stitching, and that helps to secure the trim so that in case it comes loose, it will stop falling off when it hits that neck join. And instead of breaking the trim, I'm just going to turn, lay the trim across, and go back the other direction. Now that the collar is on, we're going to prepare the center front for the buttonholes to go in. So the first thing we need to do is we need to secure this center front edge to the canvas. Now, the reason that I left it unbasted until now is because we want the layers to be able to move freely. So if I hold it flat, you can see that these edges are mostly lined up, right? But once I fully fold it, you can see that they're slightly more offset. So in order to make sure that that stays in the correct position and that we're not pulling the canvas weirdly or sending anything out of alignment, we're going to hold the garment flat on our lap, and then we're going to roll this edge back as we baste an eighth of an inch from the edge. And this is a short baste. It's not even like a running stitch, it's just a short distance and then a small pick. Let me zoom here. So you can see I have the edge folded back. Small pick, and another small pick, and then draw. And this is all happening an eighth of an inch away from the cut edge of the wool, which is really what we're focusing on. The canvas is there to support it, but in the end, it's the exterior fabric that carries sort of the truth of what the garment is supposed to become. You can see this little smoothing motion that I'm making with my left thumb as I set up for each stitch. I'm smoothing this way up into the edge, and that's just to make sure that I don't leave too much slack. That just helps make sure that it's firmly wrapped around the canvas, but not too much or too little. Okay, and now I'm at the end and I can take an extra stitch in one spot. And then I can cut this. The next step is going to be to turn it the other direction so that the cut edge is pointing up. And then I'm going to fold this edge back about 3/8 of an inch, which is what my seam allowances are. And then I'm carefully going to stitch it in place. Now I'm going to go through these layers plus the canvas itself, but I'm trying hard not to go through to the outside. The very edge of this will have a piece of trim over it, so if I do go all the way through to the outside, it's not the end of the world, but I'm still trying as much as possible to avoid having a white basting stitch go through to the outside, because this is going to be a permanent line that we're doing right here. That's what we're looking like on the outside, so you can see where the stitches are getting caught, because I'm catching the back of the outer layer of wool, but they're not going all the way through to the outside to create a white stitch. So I approach this seam for where the collar joins onto the body, just taking a couple of extra stitches across the seam right here at the edge, just to give it extra security. And then we'll just continue on up to the outer edge. Take two stitches in one place, one, two, and then I can cut it off. So in this step, I'll just do this real quickly. We are repeating the same process we did for the left front, only we're doing it on the right front. And the goal is just to baste the wool to the interlining along the center front edge. So we'll start exactly the same way. We're just going to do a small regular baste. And I've got the fabric, or got the garment piece face down here with the edge rolled back like this to allow for the displacement of the layers, so that when we actually press and stitch the seam allowance into position, we're not causing a bubble in the interlining. Alrighty, that part's done. The next thing we'll do is we'll turn the garment around, and then we'll fold the seam allowance down and baste the seam allowance into place. And once that's done, then we'll go to the iron and we'll press it, and we'll be ready to move on to the next step. Again, the seam allowance is only 3/8 of an inch on this garment. Make sure that you don't turn too much fabric out of the way, because if you do, then you're going to start reducing the size of the garment and it'll be too tight to wear. And just for extra security, right here at the neckline seam, I am going to take a couple of extra stitches just to make sure that it stays secure. And then I'll turn and I'll begin working my way down the garment's front. Now I'm taking extra care, just as I did on the left front, I'm taking extra care here not to go all the way through the fabric. At the very most, I'm catching the back of the backside of the threads that are on the surface fabric, but I'm not penetrating through to the outside. And again, just as I did with the left front, I'm leaving this open within about 2 inches of the bottom, and that gives me some working room so that when the skirts go on, I'm not having to remove any basting in order to work with that seam allowance. So now I'll go to the iron and I'll press it. So I have basted my seam allowance in place. That's a permanent basting, and I've given it a good strong pressing. I've got my strip of 3-inch wide bias cut silk. It can be cut from a piece of scrap. I have the seam allowance pressed up, and that's about 3/8 of an inch as well. Now, there aren't any skirts attached to this, so when I begin, I want to make sure that I leave a nice amount that's free so that when it comes time for me to apply the skirts, I'm not fighting a fully secured facing. So I'm going to leave about 2 inches unstitched at the bottom. And now I will start. Now, you could either fell this in place or pick stitch it in place. I prefer pick stitching because I like the way the stitches look, but fell stitches are more common in surviving garments. I will also say that as far as surviving garments are concerned, a lot of these facings for the buttonholes are not actually cut on the bias. I prefer them cut on the bias because especially for beginners, when you're stitching your buttonholes, there's less likelihood of the fabric fraying out of the stitches that you're in the middle of working. If you are an expert and you can stitch your buttonhole very accurately and quickly, then it's perfectly fine to use a straight grain piece of fabric. I just prefer the bias because I find it to be less fussy, especially for beginners. And most of the people that I'm teaching how to sew are not experts when it comes to handwork. So for that reason, I tend to use bias. Now, for the sake of photography, I am using a contrasting color thread. I think that it looks really good on camera, and I think that it helps the student actually see the stitches very well. So I prefer using a matching color if I'm going to make it as a final piece. But for the purposes of explanation, I'm using a contrasting thread. Now that the pick stitching is done along the front edge, I am about to baste down the far edge of this silk. And this doesn't have to be particularly pretty, but the one important thing is that these stitches cannot penetrate through to the outside. So you have to be very careful to keep your stitches quite shallow in order for them to just barely get into the canvas and maybe touch a little bit of the threads of the wool on the backside. And just as we did at the beginning, I'm going to stop about 1.5 inches shy of the final cut edge at the bottom because that leaves me room to maneuver when I'm attaching the skirts to the garment. Okay, I'm going to cut my thread. And now we are going to mark some buttonholes. Here we are standing at the ironing board. I will place the first buttonhole. I'm going to work left to right. So this is the front right here. I'm going to place a finger just below the neckline seam, and I'm going to make a mark with my chalk. And then I'm going to use 2 finger widths between each mark. 3, 4, 5, 6. 7, 8. Nine and 10. And then down below here, once the skirts go on, there will actually be little eyelets put in here and here, very close to the seam. And those are for lacing the garment shut at the bottom. But I'm not putting those eyelets in until after everything else is finished. Those happen after the rest of the buttonholes are complete. Now that I have the placement of the buttonholes along this axis, now I need to place the front end of the buttonholes. Now, most period garments with this type of trim pattern have a line or two of trim that goes right along the center front edge.
So even though I'm going to place them what appears to be slightly far back from the edge, it will look much better once the center front trim is on. So I'm going to start here and I'm going to make a mark, and it's right at just shy of 3/8 of an inch. And you can tell where that is because you can feel the seam allowance underneath. You really want the end of the bar tack to be, or pardon me, you really want the end of the buttonhole to be right at the edge of your allowances inside. It keeps them nice and strong. Okay. Now I'm going to use a pinking tool that is the right size for the buttonholes I need. Now, if you need larger buttonholes, you should either get a larger buttonhole cutter, or you should use very sharp snips and mark the full width of the buttonhole on the back end, like so. These buttonholes need to be about 1/2 inch long, slightly larger, maybe 5/8 of an inch long, and that accommodates a nice round button that's maybe 3/8 of an inch in diameter. Okay, our next step will be basting around these buttonholes.
Our next step is going to be basting around these buttonholes. Now I've made all of my marks. Now I need to secure the layers together, because once I start cutting these holes open and stitching them, I really don't want anything to shift. It's a diagonal baste, and we work in a simple course around each buttonhole. So I'm only taking 3 or 4 stitches along the side of each buttonhole, and I'm keeping it a good distance away from the actual line where I'm going to cut it. And that just helps keep me from running into my basting stitches as I'm trying to work the buttonhole. If I secure these basting stitches in place with a bunch of buttonhole stitches, then it's going to make it very difficult for me to remove these basting stitches without leaving behind little white fuzzy bits that'll stick out of the fabric. We really don't want that, because it will mar the beauty of the garment. You can see how I don't really need to move the piece of fabric around too much. I'm just shifting my stitching line over and continuing around. I am going through all layers, so you can see on the back side how the stitches look. And this is all meant to just secure these layers very tightly. Those of you who are familiar with the first edition of Volume 1 of the Doublet book, you'll recall that we inserted a piece of linen behind where the buttonholes are supposed to be stitched, with the idea that it was going to stiffen them. Sad reality is that it makes it a little bit too bulky, and I've done more research since then and come to find that this stiffening strip that I attempted to put inside that doublet is not something that really exists in surviving garments unless the fabric is particularly delicate. So, for example, if I'm making a garment out of a lightweight linen canvas and a lightweight silk exterior, I might use an extra layer of linen behind the buttonholes just as an extra strength measure. But when the garment is made with a heavy interlining like this one is, and a heavy wool on the outside like this one is, then it becomes unnecessary. So I've omitted that step in the reworking of Volume 1. This is the last buttonhole on the front. So I reach the end. I'll take 2 stitches in the same place and I'll cut. Now we come to cutting open and actually working the buttonholes. So I'm going to fold my fabric in half. I'm going to put a little clip, and that goes through all the layers. And then I'm going to use the snips to cut to the front. And then I will use the snips to cut to the back tack mark. And I have a nice open hole. I will immediately begin to stitch the hole. Buttonholes are worked in a number of different ways. This is the way that I prefer. I've knotted my thread, and I'm going to begin by putting my needle between all of the layers and entering the fabric some distance away. And there will be a little knot that just stays lightly on top of the fabric, and that's okay. I will cut it off later. I'm going to exit the needle right in line, about an eighth of an inch away from the cut, but right in line with where I marked my bar tack. And then I'll gently pull through. I will jump to the end. I'll cross over to the other side, and I'll gently pull through. I'll do this twice. And this is called stranding the hole. And what this does is it provides two things. It provides a little bit of structure. It also provides some horizontal strands of the correct color underneath the buttonhole. Now, my final pass, I'm going to poke to the inside, and I'm going to exit the buttonhole through the throat of the buttonhole. So I'm coming up through the cut. Next, I'll turn my work, and I'll begin on the left side of the hole at the top. This is different from the order of operations that I originally published in Volume 1. So now I have my needle where it needs to be. I'm going to grab the threads that are in the head of the needle, and I'm going to wrap them counterclockwise around the sharp end of the needle as it comes out. Now, if you look at how this is knotted, if you look at how it's knotted around the thread, you can see that there's an extra twist, and that's what gives the buttonhole its unique appearance at the throat. And I'll keep doing this. I have a single strand of silk. I'm going to come up. I'm going to wrap. And I'm going to pull snug. Now, I'm not pulling incredibly tight. I don't want to crunch the fibers down. I just want to snug the stitch into place. And I'm trying to make stitches that are very uniform. I'm allowing the needle to come up just a short distance away from the previous stitch. Again, trying very hard not to grab more than an eighth of an inch of the materials. Now on the back side, I'm definitely catching the silk. I have my finger underneath and I can feel the needle rubbing against it, and I can see in the hole. So I know exactly where I'm placing the stitch. And as I work, you can see that I catch the silk on the back side. In comparison to the version of this buttonhole that I published originally in Volume 1, this reduces the number of passes you have to take around the hole, which makes the hole slightly softer as well and easier to button. Now, there are a couple of different styles of end tack for buttonholes that I've seen on surviving garments. The most common, I'm pushing my needle into the throat, right into the corner, and taking my last stitch. And the most common bar tack or end tack that we see in surviving garments is one that has more buttonhole stitches on it. So you'll take 1, 2, 3 stitches across the end, turn the work. Now, these buttonhole stitches are not actually going through the cut, right? They're going just into the surface of the fabric over the three stitches that I just made. And I'm going to pull the thread so that the head of the buttonhole stitch is facing the opening. When I reach the stitch that's in line with the center of the buttonhole, I will actually go through all layers in the buttonhole and up through all of the layers so that I know that it's very well secured. Oops. Okay. Now that I'm in this place, I will plunge the needle back down into the fabric and up through the cut. I'll turn the work. And now I'll proceed with my buttonhole stitches 1/8 of an inch from the cut all the way down the opposite side. Hi everyone. So something came up that I need to demonstrate, and that is that this wool frays very easily. And as you can see in this first buttonhole that I created, it has already begun to pull out of the stitches. So we need to prepare the area just a little bit differently in order to keep that from happening. What we'll do is we'll cut a piece of thread and we will back stitch around the hole. And these stitches don't have to be particularly small, they just have to be firm enough to hold the layers together and keep them from shifting and give us something to grip against when we take our stitches. So in this case, we're just going to add an extra step before we cut the hole. So just the same way that I would normally strand the hole, I'm going to come in here and I'm going to come from a distance, and I'm going to carry the thread between the layers. I have a knot over here, which I'll cut off later. But I'm just going to take a few back stitches along the length of the buttonhole. Sorry, my basting's trying to get in the way. I've got to cut this off here. And then I will move to the other side. Turn the work and do the same thing. Now these stitches are going to be covered, so I'm not particularly concerned that on one side I've got stem stitch and on the other side I've got a back stitch. This is more about the mechanics of what those stitches are doing and less about how they look. Okay. now, if you look at the back there, you can see I've got my two lines of stitching. Now I can cut the hole open. So I'm going to do that by folding exactly perpendicular across the buttonhole edge. I'm going to use very sharp snips, and I'm going to cut in. Okay, my buttonhole's been cut open now. I'm going to strand the hole next. And since I put those back stitches in, I don't want the buttonhole to be overly bulky, so I'm only going to do one set of strands here. Okay, and then on my final pass, I'm going to come up through the hole. And then I'm going to turn the work. And I'm going to begin by shoving the needle up as high as it goes, coming through the fabric, wrapping counterclockwise, and pulling snug. And each successive stitch goes right next to the one before. It comes out counterclockwise around the needle and draw down. When I say counterclockwise around the needle, I'm talking about the threads that are hanging in the head of the needle, right in the eye. And then I'm going to wrap counterclockwise, and then I'm going to pull so that the knot ends up in the throat of the hole, in the cut. And when I reach the end of the buttonhole, I'm going to take 1, 2, 3 stitches across the full width, and then I'll turn the work, and I'll continue my buttonhole stitches. Now I'm only going into just the surface of the fabric as I take these stitches, but I'm making sure to go all the way around the 3 stitches that I just took across the end, the bar tack. What this does is it creates the illusion that you have worked full buttonhole all the way around in a big rectangle around this cut. Okay, now the needle comes down into the fabric and back out the cut again. And I will turn the work. And I'll continue down the opposite side of the buttonhole. Now that I'm here, I'm going to put the needle in through the hole and out at the back of these stitches, and then I will once again take 3 stitches across the end of the hole. So 1, 2, 3. And again, we'll turn the work. And this is the same as before. We're going into the surface of the fabric. And we're making sure to get around our tack stitches. And then we're taking more buttonhole stitches. These are fully knotted buttonhole stitches so that we have that very nice, sturdy, historically accurate buttonhole. Okay, and then you take the thread through to the back. And once you're on the back side, we'll take a couple of stitches in one place. And then I will tunnel through between the layers, exit somewhere else, and then I'll clip my thread. And that leaves a tail, but buries it inside the fabric so that you don't have ends hanging out everywhere. Now we have a nice, clean, strong buttonhole. And these knots here at the back end that show where I started, all I have to do with those is just lay my scissors very flat to the surface and grab the knot and clip it off. And then they disappear. With the fronts complete, my next task is going to be to stitch the center back seam. Now, in the same way that I had to prepare the fronts, the center fronts of the garment with basting along the very edge, I have to do the same with the center back edge. Now, I'm just laying it face down and then rolling it back, and that naturally causes the roll to happen, or the displacement to happen. You can see that I have some canvas starting to peek out here. Now what will happen is I will trim that away as soon as this is basted, because I absolutely don't want the edge of the canvas causing a false understanding of where the seam allowance actually is. So we have to trim it away in this spot to make sure that we don't make the seam allowance incorrect later. As I get closer to the top, I'll approach the wool padding that's been pad stitched in the back of the garment here. And once I'm there, I have to make sure to use my fingers to hold the wool out of the way. And I'm going to continue to do that, just hold the wool out of the way as I work with this seam until the seam is actually sewn. Only then will I actually trim away the excess wool out of the seam allowance, because I want to make sure that I get as close as possible to where the stitching is, and I really don't want to get it too far away, because it does help to support the back of the neck. So here I am at the wool, and you can see that I'm just slipping my finger underneath and folding it back as I work. And this just helps keep everything tidy and it'll make it easier to cut away later, because it won't be stitched to the interlining. Okay, that's done. Now we'll do exactly the same thing with the other side. Okay, real quickly here, I'm just going to trim away the excess canvas from the center back seam. And while I'm doing this, I'm also catching the little fuzzies from the actual wool as it's slightly frayed along the center back edge. And all of this is to make sure that I get a really clean center back line so that I can sight my seam allowance really well. Because when you're hand sewing, you know, it's kind of slow going and you get a little off track. So the tidier you can make, there you go, see, it's nice and clean. The tidier you can make the center back edges, the better. We'll do the second one. There it is, it's all done. And now I'm ready to baste the center back seam and then stitch it closed. Once we stitch it, then we're going to put some trim around it, and then we'll move on to assembling the side back seam. All right, here we are about to baste our center back. I have my basting thread ready. Now I have to keep these wool bits folded back out of the way, so you can see here. So I'm actually going to baste into them and nail them in place. I'll take two big stitches right in the same place, and that just holds them open, so they don't have to worry about them folding back into place when I'm trying to stitch the center back seam. And you can see that I'm very carefully matching the cut edge of the fabrics. And I'm trying to make sure that I put my needle into the fabric at a very oblique angle, which will help prevent the layers from shifting as much. And I'm basting more or less in line with my line of basting at center back, because it's a good distance away from the edge, but not so far that it's going to affect our accuracy. And the reason we stitch to the inside when we're basting is because we really want to have all of that control positioned on the body side of the garment. We don't want to have any control in the seam allowance. That's not where the important fit is going to be, right? It's going to be to the interior of the garment. So we want to make sure that we baste to the inside of where you're going to be stitching. Okay. That is done. Now I'm going to reload my needle with the correct silk thread for doing this, and then I will move on to the next step. Okay, here we are. We are basted, ready to go. Now it doesn't really matter which end you start at. You can start at the collar or start at the waist. It doesn't matter. It's a relatively straight seam. But as in previous examples of backstitch, I am going to start at the left end of the seam. And the reason I do this is I'll start with a stem stitch rather than a backstitch. And the reason I do this is because I find it very awkward to work backstitch at the right hand end of any piece of fabric. You're sort of hanging in the air. There's really not much to grip onto. You have no control over the fabric at that point. So I start at the left end using a stem stitch and just making sure that I get a good solid stitch. And then after a few inches, I plunge the needle through to the other side, turn the fabric over, and I'll do a standard back stitch for the rest of the seam. But I just like to get it started this way because I find that it's much more effective. Okay, and here we go. Standard back stitch. Now, I'm not obsessing over whether I make these stitches particularly small. I'm making them very secure. That's really important. But when it comes to what size the stitches should be, really it's the fabric that is going to regulate that for you, coupled with your skill with the needle and the size of the needle that you're working with and the strength of your hands. So your average stitch size is going to shift a little bit over time. There are moments where I'll focus on making something a little bit bigger or smaller, depending on the type of seam that it is and you know how stressed that seam is going to be. But for the most part, I can find a comfortable working rhythm in the fabric. It really just guides me to what it needs the stitch length to be. And particularly with backstitch, because of the angles that the needle enters and exits the fabric, your actual seam will appear as though it's being stitched with a stitch length that's about half of what you're actually sewing. So knowing that, there's no reason to really fight to have particularly teeny-weeny stitches. Like, there's no need for that. Okay, I'm about to enter the area that is where the wool is. So I'm going to just carefully control the cut edges of the fabric. Since the wool has been tacked back with our basting, we can pretty much just pretend it doesn't exist. The only complication is going to be with my fingers, which are carrying the thimble and the needle. It takes a little bit of dexterity to learn how to work around the bulk of the wool, but you'll get it. It doesn't take long. Once that's done, I will take it to the iron, I'll press it, I'll press it open really well. I don't necessarily need to stitch it open because I'm going to be applying trim, which will on its own naturally hold the seam allowance in place because the stitches can be made to penetrate all the way through to the allowance. You see how I'm holding this so that the majority of the fabric is kind of off and falling over my knee? That the friction between the layers of fabric and the clothing that I'm wearing actually acts a little bit like a grip, and it gives me something to tug against as I'm stitching, which helps my stitches become more even and I can pull tighter and it makes them stronger. Pulling tight on a seam like this is actually pretty important. You don't want to leave any gaps in the work, which will then become a weakness as the fabrics shift during wear. So I'm going to stitch backwards on the same line, just a few stitches, and then I'll cut. Now, in order to press this open, I can't have my basting in place, so I know that I've stitched it, I know it looks good, so I'm just going to pluck the basting out. And it's just the basting that I use to hold the seams together. I don't need to worry about the basting that's holding the surface fabrics together. That comes out later. Okay. Now remember I said I wouldn't trim the wool until after the seam was sewn? Well, that time is now. So I can see where my stitching is. I'm gonna zoom in for this because I think it's important. So I can see where my stitching line is. I'm going to cut about 1/8 of an inch to the inside of that. That 1/8 of an inch accounts for the bulk that will be present once this is turned back, because the green linen itself, the interlining, will actually take up some of that room once it's bent back. I'm going to turn it over and I'll do the same thing. So the seam allowance was 3/8 of an inch, so I'm trimming back approximately 1/2 inch, and that gives me enough room to manipulate the seam allowance and get my trim stitch down, and it should have good support when it's done. Okay, now I'm off to the iron. We're at the iron. We are ready to press the seam allowance. So you can see that I've stitched it. You can actually see how tight I pulled my stitches because it's bubbling just a little bit, and that's good. So I'll start by taking the iron and just pressing it flat without actually pressing it open or doing any manipulations. The one thing I will do is I'm going to give the seam allowance right here at the back of the neck just a tiny little stretch. And what that does is, without clipping, it enables the seam allowance to open and lie flat. Okay, here we go. Oh, it's so exciting. I love it when the center back seam goes together. There's so much work that happens before we get to this point. And once this goes in, then it starts to feel like it's turning into an actual garment, and I really love that. So I'm gonna come at the collar from both directions because there's, you know, there's shaping that happens in the back. I don't really wanna squash it out. So I'll work my way into the neckline from the top, and I worked my way up from the back. Now it's pressed. I'm going to give it one more press from the outside just to secure the textile into the fold. Then I'll go back to my chair and I'll start sewing. I'll sew the trim really quickly, just one line on either side of this seam. And then we'll move forward. I'm ready to begin applying the trim. I'll start with the upper edge and I'll do one long line all the way down. It's a little awkward because the seam is long, but you'll get the hang of it. Once that line is done, then I'll just turn the garment around and come back the other way. Now this is my trim. This is a braid, a commercial braid, and it has a more modern looking side, and then it has kind of a more period looking side. So of course I'm going to use the more historic looking side because I think that it looks nice on this garment. All right. So the trim application is no different than it was on the collar. It's just a running stitch done right in the middle of this trim. And I'm pulling snug enough to make sure that it's secure. And I'm actually aiming to catch a little bit of the seam allowance on the underside as well. And that will help hold that allowance in place and serve as the stitching to keep it open. But I do want to make sure that I have at least a little bit of distance, a little bit of fabric showing between the seam and the trim. I don't want to butt the edge of the trim right up along the seam, because then you'll see no separation between the two lines. And it's that separation that gives the sensation of opulence, because it makes it look like there's so much more trim happening on the garment. Okay, I am very nearly done with this line of trim. So I'm going to get all the way to the end and I'm going to secure my stitching thread, but I'm not going to cut the trim. I'm just going to leave a little loop and I'll turn around and go back the other direction on the other side of the seam. So there's that. I'll turn the garment, leave a nice little loop of trim below the edge, and I'll pass my thread, my needle through to the other side, and I will begin stitching. You see, I have to crunch up a bunch of this back in my hand in order to get my fingers to where they need to be. Don't worry if you have to do this. It's important to be able to have the right grip on the trim. The rest of the garment, if you've made it correctly, should be perfectly fine for you to crunch up just a little bit while you're working. We can always press it back out later. Remember, these garments are supposed to be sturdy and strong, so if you're fearful that it's too delicate, you might want to revisit your construction.